Okay, so thank you very much to the organizers for inviting me to this beautiful place and very nice school. So I was asked to give an introductory lecture on this subject, and the subject I will touch is this that I name Panleve gauge theory correspondence. In brief, this means that supersymmetric partition function of a special class of gauge theories provide general solutions of Panleve equations in tau form. And what I like about this correspondence is that it is systematic. It is known that, a connection between Panleve equations and many physical or mathematical physics systems arised in many places, in statistical theory, or in random matrices, or in quantum gravity. The aspect that I like about this correspondence is that in this case we have a full correspondence within the full set of Panleve equations, not just some examples of them, and a full set of supersymmetric partition functions of a class of gauge theories that I will explain in the talk. And actually this story generalizes also to ODEs, which are not of second order like Panleve, but of higher order, and also to Q difference equation. I will comment also on that later. And another aspect that I like about this correspondence is that you can do things with it. It's not just a dictionary between two subjects, but you can use then this dictionary to learn new things. On one direction, it gives for the first time the general solution to these nonlinear equations in terms of an explicit formula, a combinatorial one, which has many links then to other systems like enumerative geometry, integrable systems, and so on. And on the other side, it is useful to give hints on the non-perturbative description of this class of gauge theories. So the plan of the talk is to start by reviewing what are Panleve equations, so analysis, ODE, then to reformulate Panleve equations in geometrical terms as isomonodromic deformation of some flat connection on some Riemann surface, and then use this geometrical picture to associate to these Riemann surfaces quantum field theory, and in particular gauge theories, and then we will discuss the solution you find in this corner and the connection of this explicit combinatorial formula with, as I said, non-perturbative gauge theory, quantum integrable systems, and enumerative geometry. And so you already saw a picture in the next slide. Before starting the talk, I wanted to remind Boris Dubromin that he gave big contributions to this field, and it was a big loss for our department. He went away some months ago, so I wanted just to remind him. Yeah. Okay. So let me start with the review of what are Panleve equations. So I don't know why it goes two eyes. Okay. So it was known since very long ago that several linear ODEs can be used to define special functions. For example, the hypergeometric equation gives rise to the Gauss hypergeometric function. Okay, is a general solution which is valid, can be analytically continued in the complex plane, and admits integral representation, very nice properties. And then from this observation, people started asking if it's possible to use more in general non-linear ODEs to define a new special function which go beyond the ordinary special function that were known at that time, and so they were called the transcendental. And okay, this is just okay an idea and an observation which gave some concrete hint towards the realization of this idea was due to Poincaré and Kovalevskaya, namely that the solution of ordinary differential equations that appear in integrable systems are free from movable branch points. So this led to the definition of what is called the Panleve property. Panleve property is enjoyed by non-linear ordinary differential equation whose solutions admit poles that can be moved by changing the initial condition, and no other special points of the complex function can be moved. So, for example, branch points cannot be moved by changing the initial condition. So, to give a very simple example of first order, this equation here has of course a simple solution, which is this one. So changing the initial time, you change the pole, and so this is of enjoys the Panleve property. This instead has a movable algebraic branch point, because there is this branch cut due to the from m bigger than 1, and so this is not in the realm of Panleve equation, must be erased. So the question arises how to classify these ODEs, and ODEs that obey the Panleve property and which are first order in the time derivative were classified by Fuchs and Poincaré and are only of two types, so the Weierstrass equation and the Riccati equation. And for second order ODE, the problem is much more complicated, and was started, the classification was started by Panleve and Gambier. And then really by trial and error, and then the general form is of this kind. So you have a second derivative and then a rational function in the function itself and its first derivative and meromorphic in time. So it was found that the most general second order equation that obeys Panleve property is what is called the Panleve 6. In a moment we will understand why this 6, and this is the explicit form, and you see that this contains critical points at 0, 1 and infinity in the coefficients of the derivative. Okay, and then what it was found is a coalescence diagram, which is the following, by using the which, by doing some suitable scaling limits on the parameter on which this equation depends, and rescaling also the coordinates and the function, one can go from this Panleve 6, which is the most general one, to other Panleve equations. So this is a full classification of second order non-linear ODEs that satisfy the Panleve property. So you have a flow diagram in which by colliding the singularity and making some suitable rescalings of the parameters, you can go towards the different Panleve equations. Also confluent diagram, yeah. Now we will reformulate this diagram in terms of geometry, and this will also explain in a more deep terms why there is this classification, gives an origin to this classification. So actually Pandeva equations are known to arise from isomonodromic deformation problem. So you start from a linear system of this kind, so something that was discussed also this morning by Professor Kichever, and then you have a matrix here, matrix valued meromorphic function with some singularity, okay, and with some coefficients which are matrix valued. Z is the affine coordinate on a punctured sphere, and one on the sphere, one can introduce a family of flat SL2C connections, which depend on the geometric moduli, namely the sphere with punctures will have some a moduli space, so some coordinates parametrizing this moduli space. For example, the sphere with four punctures, you know that by using PSL2C you can put three of the four punctures at 0, 1, at infinity, and then you are left with the conformal cross ratio, which is the fourth coordinate, which is just one parameter t. So in this case you have an extra parameter, and then the isomonodromic problem, it is asking what are the deformations of this connection, okay, of this problem, that leave the monodromy around the singular points of this matrix fixed. This gives a system, so this is the original equation of the linear system, and this is the isomonodromic deformation problem, okay, which introduces a second matrix, okay, and compatibility of this system implies a relation between these two matrices. Of course, the compatibility means that if I derive psi with respect to z and then with respect to t, I get some equation from this side, and this must be equal to the derivative with respect to z and with respect to t of psi, which gives something acting on this left-hand side. Then equating them gives this equation, okay? This equation says that the infinitesimal variation of the flat connection A is nothing but a gauge, an infinitesimal gauge transformation, which is generated by the matrix B. So this leads precisely to Pandeva equations, and the matrices A and B are can be identified with a Lex pair. And in particular, if one goes to the limit of kappa going to zero, this morning this kappa was called H bar by Kichever, you go from the isomonodromic system to the isospectral problem, and so this isospectral problem is isospectral for the operator A. So this are deformation of the connection which leave invariant the spectrum of A, not the monodromies around some singular point, but the spectrum of A, which can be encoded in this, of course, in this singular equation, which is called the spectral curve of the system. And this is something that leaves in the cotangent bundle to the Riemann surface with punctures, okay? And there is also a very nice connection of all this with a Hitchin integrable system, but I don't have time to review this. So maybe later I will comment on that if time is left. So there is some question? Ah, okay. So to give an example, let me take the simplest Pandeva equation. That is Pandeva 1, okay? And you see that this can be reformulated in as an Hamiltonian equation. So the second order equation is, if you want, like a Newton equation, and this is the Hamiltonian form. And this is the natural form that arises from compatibility between this of the Lax pair. Okay? An important point is that the Hamiltonian of this system is time dependent. So it is what is called a non-autonomous Hamiltonian system. And so one can associate to this a tau function, which is the generating function of the Hamiltonian, and the Pan-Levy equation can be reformulated in terms of equation for this tau function. And these are the Pan-Levy equation in the tau form, which are directly connected, then we will see, with the gauge theory. And then the geometric data of this are associated. In this case, I'm doing just SL2, so the only invariant is the Casimir trace of A squared. And this is the quadratic differential of the covering, so it is an element in the symmetric product of T star of C. And the spectral curve is a torus, okay, which is given by this. It's an elliptic curve. This is the example of Pan-Levy 1, but of course one can classify all these Lax pairs, and then all the geometries which are involved in the Pan-Levy system. So now you understand why, the Pan-Levy 6 is related to the sphere with four punctures, and then further degenerations produce all the other Pan-Levy. So there is a geometric reinterpretation of this flow diagram in terms of the Riemann surfaces where the isomonodromic problem is formulated. So Pan-Levy 6, as I said, corresponds to a sphere with four punctures. Then you can make to collide the punctures, and then you will produce from regular singularities, so you will produce irregular ones. And then you can continue the process until the end. So this is corresponding to Pan-Levy 1. You see that, for Pan-Levy 1, what you get is a quadratic differential that has an irregular singularity just at infinity and no singularities at the origin. And the degree of the singularity can be read from the number of spikes here, which is related to the Stokes ray. So in the case of regular punctures, there are no Stokes rays because you have a regular singularity. But as you start colliding the punctures, you will have Stokes rays, which are in the number equal to the degree of the singularity is minus 2. This is a seventh order singularity at infinity, and so you have 5 stock rays, which is the Z5 symmetry of the Pan-Levy 1. So this is the geometrical translation, and it shed light on the deep motivation why there is this classification, okay? Because you can to have just one deformation parameter, you start from the sphere with four punctures with SL2, and then the only thing you can do is hit that here, okay? There is nothing left, and this is exhaustive one. And now we have to pass from geometry to quantum field theories. And this is the more delicate point. And then we have to use something that maybe is not familiar to many of you in the audience. So I have to wear somehow a magic hat. The magic hat is the theory called M theory. M theory is a non perturbative formulation of superstrings that still is a bit elusive. We know only some limits of it, but still in this context can be used to derive the very concrete results. So the I mean, DM does not stand for magic, but rather maybe for membrane or mother, or it's not very clear, but membrane is good because the elementary excitation of this theory are extended objects which are M2 brains, so really membranes in the physical sense, so surfaces which evolving in time span a three-dimensional manifold, and another object which is a bit more exotic to think about it is M5 brain. What is the origin? I can spend just one single word on the origin is that if you formulate quantum field theories and you assume that in quantum field theories there are only point particles, so this is inconsistent because the self-energy of a point particle is infinite. Then the original idea goes back to Dirac to say, okay, so let's think about extended objects. And the extended object, if you then try to formalize it mathematically in a rigorous way, you will find that only some dimensions are allowed to avoid the infinities, and these are the dimensions that are allowed in the M theory. Okay? So the particle is extended to the excitation of a membrane, which is, I mean, also physically is not. What is less intuitive is that the space-time now becomes 11-dimensional, so one has to see what happens of the extra dimensions that you get. And but in this case is very convenient because the N5 brain, when they move in time, they span a six-dimensional space, like a particle moving in time span a line. Okay, and then you have associate to a space of dimension 2 a space of dimension 4, so you have the chance to associate to a Riemann surface a four-dimensional gauge theory. How this happens? You consider the M5 brains on flat space-time, R4, times the Riemann surface. So you place these M5 brains in this geometry, and then when you make these Riemann surfaces very small, you get effectively a four-dimensional theory, which depends on the details of this Riemann surface. In particular, the number of M5 brains that you wrap give the rank of the gauge theory group, and the punctures on C, which more specifically are the behavior of the singular points of K differential, which are describing the covering by the M5 brains of this geometry, give the matter content of the gauge theory, so the quarks. Okay? So,
but you really assume that one direction of the six is the time of the M5
is Euclidean time. Yeah. Everything is in the Euclidean.
But somehow you have a preferred direction, which is the time, and five.
I mean, if you do Euclidean, then it's not preferred anymore because they are treated all on the same footing, no? So, but the point is that the output are very concrete objects. Because these M5 brains realize an R covering of the Riemann surface. And the R covering is encoded in a polynomial where these are K differentials on the Riemann surface with punctures. And this is an element of the cotangent bundle, a section of the cotangent bundle. So this is again is a spectral curve, and the point is that this spectral curve can be identified for suitable geometries precisely with the spectral curve associated to the Pan-Levé system. Okay? So, in particular, this A, which describes the covering of the Riemann surface by the M5 brain, coincide with the Lax connection appearing in the isomonodromic system. So they are identified one-to-one. So the bonus of this is that now we can associate to the Riemann surfaces a specific gauge theory. So we have a list of quadratic differentials, okay? And you can pass from one to the others by doing some limits which have a specific meaning from the viewpoint of gauge theory. For example, you can pass from what is called, here you have, for example, this corresponds to the sphere with three punctures, where you have two regular and one irregular. Okay? Since you have three punctures, you have three quarks, so three generation of matter, and so it is called in the language of gauge theory NF equal to 3, and the quadratic differential is this. Then physically you can think that you decouple one of the masses but sending it to infinity and rescaling the coupling in such a way that you get some product fixed. And so you see that in this way, if you send this to zero and this mass to infinity, you reproduce this term and you erase this constant term, okay, here. And again, you can do the same procedure going on. So this, from the viewpoint of gauge theory, is what is called the renormalization group flow. Yeah. This?
No, the one forward.
Ah, okay. This one? Ah, okay. Now we will discuss this slide. So you see that from the confluence diagram translated in geometric terms, we associate to each Riemann surfaces, a gauge theory. So if you have four punctures, you have four quarks. Okay, and then if you decouple one, as I discussed, you go to three, and these are three punctures, and so on. And so this is the renormalization group flow diagram for the gauge theories. So to each Pan-Levy equation, you associate a specific supersymmetric gauge theory by using the fact that this geometric diagram is associated to the confluence diagram of Pan-Levy equations. Okay? And so you get the dictionary. So this is the dictionary between Pan-Levy equations and gauge theories. So you see that it is systematic and full. And then, okay, what do we do with that? The claim is that the partition functions of this four-dimensional gauge theories satisfy Pan-Levy equation in the so-called tau form. And the crucial point is that at least not all, to be honest, but at least many of these partition functions can be explicitly computed in terms of some combinatorial data, how we will explain now in the following slides. And then, in some sense, we can say that finally, we found what are these special functions that are defined by the second order non-linear PDEs with Pan-Levy property, ODEs with Pan-Levy property, okay? So finally, this is the point. And so let me...
probably a silly point, but somehow you are associated so far, just the Riemann surface, you use only the Riemann surface, no?
Yes.
So this means that you could think of other integrable systems. Because at a certain point you made the magic to cancel the coordinate or to cancel the time. But in principle, no? In the equations. But the spectral curve could be associated to other really time-depending, like sine Gordon. And then you have a spectral curve.
No, but the association is to a specific, I mean, there is only one gauge theory that corresponds to this geometry arising from map theory compactification. So it's univoque, because this is not the Cyber-Witten curve. Is another object. The Cyber-Witten curve is the spectral curve which is the covering of this. So this is really an ultraviolet description.
No, I agree, but I'm thinking about the Pan-Levy construction. So you use of the Pan-Levy this isospectral problem, and then from there you derive the if I understood.
Oh, yeah, No. I don't use the isospectral limit. I really use the isomonodromy. Pan-Levy is associated to isomonodromy because there is time dependence. So it's really univoque.
Where is
Z, you mean the coordinate on the Riemann surface? So the coordinate on the Riemann surface is in the covering. It is this quadratic. It is where the quadratic differentials are defined. So it is appearing here.
Yeah, but it doesn't appear in the Pellevé.
In the Pellevé, does not appear. It disappears. Yeah. Yes. Yeah. I mean, when you do this game here, you see that it disappears because essentially, from this, you equate the coefficients of the Z expansion. But this is the standard thing of deriving Pellevé equation from the isomonodromy from the Lax pair.
Yeah, it's a more general system, then you somehow cancel out Z.
Yeah, but the correspondence, I mean, you can have, there is not a single Lax pair that is associated to the Pellevé. This is true, but because there are gauge transformations. But this is a symmetry of the problem. Okay. Okay, so now let's give what is the problem in gauge theory? So in gauge theory, we completely change the subject. We have a gauge feed, namely a unitary connection on a vector bundle on a differential manifold that for us is just R4, as we said, and the vector bundle is just CR. This is the connection, and these are matrix valued functions. So this is the curvature of the connection, and you have the Young-Mitz-Axon function, which is the L2 norm squared of this curvature, and this is the object that we have to minimize in order to see what are the saddle points contributing to the gauge theory. And if you do the equations of motion of this action, you get second order PDEs, which are rather complicated. But there is a well-known and very important trick that reduces them to first-order PDE by using the squaring argument here. So this is the L2 norm squared of the curvature, and this is the projection using the Hodge dual operator, the Hodge star operator acting on two forms, which splits them in self-dual and anti-self-dual, which are orthogonal to each other, and this of course is greater than this, and this is a topological invariant, which is the second chain class of the bundle. So the minimal are saturated when either f plus or f minus is zero, and these are the anti or self-dual curvatures, which are called instantons or anti-instantons. And the solutions to this equation depend on some parameters, which are called moduli. So they are, it is a disjoint union of spaces with different topological numbers. Okay, and in each of these for fixed k, you have some parameters of the solution, which is the position of the instanton, the sides, and the angles. And this is the instanton moduli space, which is very well studied by these people, Atiyah, Drinfeld, Itchin, and Manin. It is a smooth hyperkähler manifold. So all in all, we are reduced to counting these solutions. How you can count these solutions? Essentially, what you do is you introduce a potential on this moduli space, and you count the critical points of this potential. And this is topologically called a Morse function. So a Morse function is a function which is an analytic function on the moduli space of instantons, which has isolated critical points. And this can be derived as the Hamiltonian of the torus action on this on this manifold. The torus action is given by the action of the Cartan of the structure group of the bundle. So we had the UR, so the Cartan is U1 to the R, and then the Cartan of the rotation group on R4, or if you want, C2. And these are very important parameters. These are the parameters that we call epsilon1 and epsilon2. So under this action, there are isolated fixed points. Okay, so this is really a theorem that this is a Morse function, so the fixed points are isolated, and they are classified by multipartitions of the instanton number, and these are multipartition. For example, this is a fixed point configuration for 6 k equal to 6, second chain class equal to 6, and then you will have organized in a partition which depends on these extra labels. So you have at the value A1 a partition with say 3 boxes, and A2 another partition with 3 boxes organized differently. Okay, so then you associate to this some weights, and then the partition function of the supersymmetric gauge theory is computed starting from associating some suitable weights to these fixed points. So let me give one explicit example, which is this corner here, which is SU2 gauge theory with no quarks, which corresponds to a cylinder with two irregular singularities of order 3, one at zero and one at infinity, from the viewpoint of Panleve, corresponds to what there is a wide nomenclature of Panleve. Here I used one of these and it is called Panleve 3-3, but there are many other names that can be attached to. But I will give the explicit form so you can recognize it. Okay, so this is the Panleve 3 equation in the radial Singh-Gordon form. And the theorem is that, known also as the Kiev solution, which was found by Oleg Lissovy and other collaborators, this specifically with Itz and help me. Itz, Lissovy, and Gamayund, maybe? Tiki. Okay. And you see that this is an explicit form. This sigma and s parameterize the initial condition of the solution, which is a second order ODE, so you have two initial conditions. And from the viewpoint of the counting the solution by instantons, you choose a special anti-diagonal group of the U1 squared we saw. So a special choice is not the most general one. This function is some known special function, is the Barn G function. And then what is very interesting and new is this object here, which is takes into account the counting of these instantons.
You have a similar formula for general omega background?
Yes.
Always in terms of Panleve function?
No, Panleve, then Panleve is only in this. And then you get, if you go outside of this limit, then probably you are, one way to see it is that you are quantizing the moduli space of flat connection over which you do the isomonodromy. So it's is not no longer Panleve, but some kind of quantum Panleve, or better, it will give Nikzitz Zamolodchikov equation. To be more precise.
Someone has written? Someone has written this equation?
This is a Zamolodchikov.
Yeah, but this.
The fact that then is solved by gauge theory, this is there is something in the literature, but not a systematic treatment.
But also, yeah. Is not. So I would say some final difference equation.
Finite difference will come in another context, but yes. So this is the instant on counting function, and as I said, is defined assigning some rational function to these fixed points. Okay? So you have a combinatorial formula which depends on the data of this fixed point set. Now I don't enter into the detail, but just to give a flavor of what are these functions, let's consider the simplest example. If you assign weight 1 to each of these partitions, so if you assign just weight 1, so not a rational function, but you sum all over these multi-partitions, you are solving a special question, namely how many ways you can write the second claim class, which is an integer, as a sum of integers, which can be the integer itself or smaller integers, okay, in this way. And the answer to this is known since a very long time, is the Dedekind eta function that satisfies very important modular properties. And this is important because it gives an analytic continuation of the solution to Pan-Levé, because you see that this object here has a finite radius of convergence, because you see that this is to the minus 2, so I mean this is a convergent series with a finite radius of convergence, but by using these properties you can analytically continue outside. Sorry? In T. Well, it depends on these coefficients. It depends on the growth of these
coefficients. Are written, no.
R?
So what is this radius? In which term it is defined?
It depends on the growth of this coefficient. Now I
mean. Yeah, I think also it's infinity because there is a certain number of parameters.
Yeah.
Sigma.
No, in sigma it's very subtle, because in sigma you have poles. Then but this is from the viewpoint of Pan-Levé are the resonant initial conditions.
Commonly it is said that the radius of convergence is finite. No, you want to say that it is infinite.
In this case,
the common belief is that it's finite.
No, but this depends. Maybe you are thinking nf equal to 4, for example, it's finite. No, because to infinity, and then in this case it's infinite. But I agree. Yeah, but because in other words, when you add masses, you add something in the numerator here, and this lowers the degree of convergence.
You are doing the theory without matter?
In this example, yes.
Ah, okay. Ah, okay.
In
that's
this example, yes.
That
yes.
Be.
Yeah.
That
okay. So now we move to the another point which is interesting, which is the quantum integrable systems. So we learned that in the correspondence between gauge theory and Pan-Levé, time, what is called the time in Pan-Levé language, is the gauge coupling. Okay? And so if I do a late time expansion of Pan-Levé, I'm working in the strong coupling regime of gauge theory, or better, more precisely, in the magnetic or dionic phase of these theories. And so this suggests a new expansion of the Pan-Levé transcendence, which is very similar to the ones we saw before. But now the parameter S is in the denominator, because now we are doing the expansion in large times, so S going to infinity. From the gauge theory viewpoint, this should connect to the dual prepotential, okay, so the S-dual free energy of the supersymmetric gauge theory. So there is no longer an interpretation, direct interpretation of these coefficients as instanton counting, because we are in the magnetic or ionic frame. But still there is some explicit result that can be derived. For the Pan-Levet-3-3 case, for example, the tau function admits a spectral determinant presentation, which can be written in this way, and so we have a specific matrix model, okay? And the large N expansion of this matrix model, we checked that is reproducing precisely these coefficients here of the dual Seiberg-Witten prepotential. Okay, and then there is an interesting fact that you can derive an analog matrix model also for the case of higher rank gauge theories. For a higher rank, the relation we leave the Pain-Levé realm and we go to other differential equation or system of differential equation. In particular, this matrix model can be seen as the Fredholm determinant for the tau function of a fine total chain. So this is a higher rank generalization of the equation we saw before, because you see here, okay, here you see that the sign appears, and then this appears when you have two particles, okay? Affine A1.
There is a relation because this looks like very similar to the matrix model found in the real no BJM, which is still connected.
Yes. There is a connection with that.
They are connected. Because
yes.
I remember this sign.
Yeah. It is connected with that in some regions, yes. So this corresponds to isomonodromic deformation not of SL2 but of SLN connection. Okay? And then one can check that it reproduces the dual Seiberg-Witten prepotential for SUN. But this all if you want, a classical Seiberg-Witten curve, but one can go to quantum. And the conjecture is the following, is that the zeros of the Fredholm determinant of the isomonodromic problem compute the spectrum of the quantum operator which is associated to the corresponding isospectral problem. Okay, this is a general statement, but what we do is a check for affine TODA, rank 2. For rank 2, the classical system is well known, is the modified Mathieu-Hamiltonian, and then by studying the zeros of the Fredholm determinant numerically, so by using this this relation, you find a good approximation for the numerical values of the spectrum of the modified Mathieu. This is for the ground state, and this is for the first excited state. And you see this number is the number of instantons we put, and so the order at which we stop the expansion, and you see that it converges rather rapidly, okay? So it is a very efficient object. And then I would like to make a comment about this. Typically, it is well known that the spectrum of a quantum integrable system associated to these supersymmetric gauge theories is derived by another limit of the instanton counting function, which is known as Nekrasov-Shatashvili, in which you set one of the two parameters to zero and the other to h bar. Here we saw that we are in a different limit, which is the self-dual, so epsilon 1 plus epsilon 2 equal to 0. But this geometrica corresponds just to a different choice of the one parameter subgroup of the Cartan-Torus action. So you have the action of the rotation group of the space-time, which is C2, and you have a U1 squared. If you leave general both epsilon 1 and epsilon 2, you are using the full group. Instead, if you specify this or this choice, you are using some subgroups. You are just changing which subgroup you are using, but the result should contain the same information. And indeed, this is the case because of blow-up equations that this function satisfy. Okay, but this is a bit...
Stopped you before.
Ah, okay.
My
time is finished?
Yeah, something like -2.
So -2. Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. So it will be very, very brief about this, which is the isomonodromy. We can go to Higher genus, and then we can go on the torus, and this we did also. This corresponds to a specific Panleve. In elliptic form, which is Panleve 6 in a specific form. Also here there is a nice connection between the isomonodromic tau function and the gauge theory partition function, and it is expressed in terms of this extra proportionality parameter, which is a twisting, which is a new term with respect to the sphere, so it is an interesting new ingredient. And you see that this formula is a generalization of the formula that has been known for a long time for the integrable system limit. In this case, the integrable system corresponding to the isospectral limit is Calogero-Moser, and it is known that the dynamics of Calogero-Moser is linearized if one works on the spectral curve, which is this, and this is the complex structure of this spectral curve, and this equation is the generalization, so it gives the solution to the non-autonomous system in terms no longer of just this simple combination of theta functions, but of the full instanton counting function. But this, I guess that Pasha will give more details in his talk tomorrow, so I don't also because. And then there is an old story about the relation with enumerative geometry, which correspond to Q difference Panleve, as he was asking, but I think that this will be the subject of Andrei's talk and the lectures, so I leave the place to him. Okay, and then I thank you. Okay.